And hello, and welcome to the Anime Exploration Podcast. My name is Alex.
I'm Tora.
I'm David.
And I'm Blaine. Sorry, there was a delay, so I thought that was the space.
That's okay. That's okay. We'll roll with it. We are a monthly anime book club podcast. And in addition to talking about the anime that we watched each month, we also talk about recent anime fandom news and announcements and what we're currently watching. So I'm going to start off real quick. Since we didn't get a chance to talk about this the new season last month, which is fine for this new season stuff. I'm just going to say that this season for anime, theater kids are eating good. We have the new season of Oshinoko, which is the anime series sort of semi-thriller-ish involving the Japanese showbiz industry. And this current season has thus far one of our two main characters, Aqua, in a stage production of stage play based on a manga, a sort of 2.5D play is what they call it. And we also have Pseudo Harem, which is a romantic comedy anime where it's about a couple of high school students, or one of whom, as her way of flirting with the guy she likes, takes on the persona of various sort of archetypes for romantic comedy anime, like tsundere, cool girl, and that sort of thing.
It's set in a high school?
Yeah, it is. It is set in the high school.
That sounds horribly confusing for any teenager.
It's a really fun show. Again, it's not like an actual sort of harem romantic comedy series. It's much more of a like just standard couple rom-com, but with fun acting bits and stuff there. And other than that, the My Hero Academia manga wrapped up. Probably going to do a thing about that on my blog at some point. But I'll just say, I think the ending was all right. It's hard to, it's tricky to really stick the landing when you've hit like 340 chapters.
The ending, like the entirety of the epilogue was what, five chapters? The final battle ended really abruptly.
I was like six or seven chapters but of the epilogue.
I want more, but at the same time, I think it was fine. Like I don't have any like problems with what happened in it.
So what are the rest of y'all watching? Does not necessarily have to be anime related either.
I rewatched Vinland Saga. And,
yeah, I got caught up. I started watching in the second season and then I went back and watched the first season. Actually preferred the second season, but
yeah, I think it's a more interesting story.
I actually know quite a bit about that era of history in which the show is set, because I kind of took a deep dive into it after playing Assassin's Creed Valhalla, and I started following this guy on YouTube named Ludo History, who is an actual historian of the Viking Age, and he actually played through that game and a bunch of other games and gave his commentary on what was historically accurate, what was not, so that was really fun. Recommend his channel.
Yeah, Vinland Saga is a pseudo-historical, like it is inspired by actual history, but it still takes a lot of liberties with the specifics,
which is fine. It's a good story first and foremost.
Yeah,
I rewatched Fushigi Yugi first time since, oh gosh, five. I don't even know, five. It doesn't hold up for me. Okay, so like I've kind of moved beyond that sort of story. Like I was obsessed with it when I was a young woman, but now I'm kind of like, all right. And the animation was so bad. It really was not great. On the other end of the spectrum, I watched the movie Suzume. And oh my God, that was a gorgeous film. And it gave me the feels by the same guy who did Your Name. Amazing movie.
Mm-hmm.
Recommend.
All right, anything you're watching recently, Blaine? Did you, outside of the stuff you're doing for podcasts?
Oh, outside of that? No, this summer I have not had time to watch outside of that, because I'm switching the schools I teach at, so there's a lot of prep work for that, and the stuff I've been running in the background has been for one podcast or another. So since last month, I have watched the episodes of She-Ra, Princess of Power from 1985 that JMS wrote, as well as the five-part opener. I have watched an anime called Bubblegum Crisis. I have watched most or at least the 2021 Best Picture winner, Coda, plus four of the other nominees, because that's coming up right away for a podcast I'm recording tomorrow. Going through those, we're jumping ahead in the recording schedule because we upgraded our phones. So we're slipping in coda while we've got that 3 months of free Apple TV Plus, because the only legal ways to see it in the English language are Apple TV Plus or tracking down, probably through eBay, that one physical English language release DVD that came out region free in Italy. That's it. It's never been physically released anywhere because Apple wants to drive people to their service. And now that we've recorded the She-Ra podcast, I've watched a little bit of Babylon 5 for that podcast. And now I am working through Jace and the Wheeled Warriors because JMS wrote apparently 14 episodes of those. There's no on-screen credit. People have tracked down 13 of them. I don't know if number 14 was unproduced or if it's one of the, I think, 47 episodes with no known writer credit. Genuinely don't know who wrote most of that series because the credits at the end list all the writers that were hired, but they don't have a this episode by credit. They just say, here's everyone in the writer's room.
Oh,
interesting approach.
Yeah.
I got to admit, just a heads up for people who are watching it, if you're interested in Jason the Wheeled Warriors, because it's probably JMS's less known regular gig, I'm three episodes in and I'm already feeling the slog, and there's 62 to go. So,
Oh my. Other as far as anime current event stuff, we had Otakon happened, and with it, Discotech Media had their big panel, and they did the a sort of extended live stream version, well, not live stream, but video version online. I don't know if either of you were able to watch it.
I didn't watch it.
But I tuned in for like 5 minutes, but then I had other stuff to do, unfortunately.
Checked out the announcements afterwards.
Yeah.
A few fun ones. I am glad that Dalos is getting a Blu-ray release. Dalos is basically, it's one of the first OVAs. It's from director Mamoru Oshii, director of Ghost in the Shell. And it is basically the movie Battle of Algiers meets the moon is the novel The Moon is the Heart's Mistress, is how I would describe it. In terms of it's a setting where the moon has been colonized and the people who live on the moon are kind of a repressed underclass and having a rebellion, basically insurrection over this. We are also getting, for those who are fans of Digimon, Digimon Adventure 2 is getting a Blu-ray release. The original series source material for Saber Rider and the Star Sheriffs, Space Musketeer Bismarck is getting a release. Most Extreme Elimination Challenge, the Spike TV Spike TV re-edit of Takeshi's Castle is getting released. So if you want to see Beat Takeshi playing something other than a gangster, there's a chance to do that.
Wow.
We were on something and came across the original Takeshi's Castle, and I was like, oh my god. And it's on some.
We recently re-upped our Max subscription
because it is now pairable with Hulu and Disney Plus. Because we have a child, we need Plus.
Yeah.
And the other one I would call notable to a degree notable, I would say. So Discotech Media picked up Kite, which specifically the release that they have is doing every single cut of the movie on there. Kite is a action anime, which basically, from what they talked about at the panel, on pressure from the financial backers, had pornographic scenes included in it. Those were removed from some of the more general releases for the U.S. general release and the international cut. And the Blu-ray gets all cuts, including a option to select, hey, is there anyone in the room who would have a problem with the more 18 plus material, in which case it blocks out those options from the menu entirely, which I think is for something like this, I think is a good way to do it. I have not seen, I've seen like trailers for Kite and of like the full version of it, the full version, but the general release version. I think I might've even gotten the general release from Netflix at one point. It is a gorgeously animated work, but it is also complicated and messy in a lot of respects to discuss, I would say. So like I'm glad that they picked this up. Like this and Belladonna of Sadness are two similarly historically interesting and visually impressive works of animation that also are complicated to recommend and talk about in a way that we're probably not going to necessarily discuss them on the podcast in the future. but from a animation studies standpoint and a film history standpoint, certainly worth looking up in that regard, I would say. But yeah, and we mentioned OVAs earlier. Speaking of OVAs, we might as well transition into this month's show, Bubblegum Crisis. Bubblegum Crisis is a direct-to-video or OVA, original video animation series, that started in 1987 and continued through 1991. So basically kind of through the later days of the bubble economy, Japanese bubble economy, with, and this was a co-production between a production company called Artmic, along with a record label called Yomix, and the animation studio and a animation studio. I think I'm getting the mixed up part. Which was Artmic and Artmic was the production company. Yomix was the studio, and AIC was the animation. And this didn't exactly go through the usual production committee process. I think that the whole concept was fairly new at the time, and this led to later on some serious production hiccups. The part of the plan was to have the main character, Princess Sagiri, be a vehicle for a pop singer, Omori Kinuko. And there was a dispute later on over use of her songs episode of the show, possibly involving nearly killing her off. We'll talk about that in a bit. And ultimately, what had been reportedly planned to be 13 episodes ended up getting truncated. So,
they were supposed to be 13-hour-long episodes. Yeah, and our 8 averaging also 40 minutes.
This is direct-to-video, so you don't have to fit it in a half-hour TV time slot. You have to instead fit it on, like, your limitation is based on, oh, this is a Betamax tape or a VHS tape or Laserdisc. So, had either of you had any previous experience with Bubblegum Crisis?
Yes. Yes, I have. My first encounter with Bubblegum Crisis was actually through the trading card game Anime Mayhem, where Bubblegum Crisis was one of the series used in its first set. That was just a chaotic, fun card game. And mostly worked until they introduced Dragon Ball Z, which just threw the power curve completely off. Because of course it. But aside from that, I also watched the Bubblegum Crisis 2040, Tokyo 2040, and yeah, enjoyed that. This is a very different show.
When I was an anime fan in the 90s and 2000s, I was always aware of Bubblegum Crisis. Like, there was a lot of talk about it, and I knew it existed. But to me, the marketing made it seem like it was a lot more fan service heavy than it actually is. So I actually avoided it. Like, I wasn't interested. And now I feel bad about that, because it covers quite a few of my interests, and it's not really that fan servicey at all.
Most of the fan service is kind of front loaded in the first three episodes, more or less.
Mm-hmm. We got them hooked. Now we can do the stuff, the serious work.
Yeah.
And you heard about the show previously before this, Blake?
I had heard about it, but not in a lot of detail. So Alex and I both write for the Bureau 42 website, and as Alex will tell you, I have been putting out, weekly columns on what's coming out on home video since the format options were VHS and DVD. Mm-hmm. So this is one I remember as, popping up as the releases came. And, back when it was just me, Alex would be saying, oh, check this out. And then Alex started co-writing that column specifically to provide better support for anime, some other interests that I couldn't really evaluate. So, yeah, I know that he's been saying this is worth watching for a while. But yes, this is the first time I've actually watched it, and he was right. This is worth watching.
Yeah. This also does connect, the series does connect a little bit to, we talked about Robotech last time. This connects a bit to Robotech and Macross. One of the main kind of character designers and mechanical designers on this is, production people, is Shinji Aramaki, who basically, if you've seen a transforming vehicle in anime, like, he is responsible for that, whether it's the Veritex, he's also heavily involved in a general production, or Valkyries, and a general production standpoint on the whole Backrush franchise. He and Artmic also worked on Megazone 2-3, which got sort of edited into Robotech the movie for a US release as well. Aramaki also worked on Genesis Climber Mospita, which was the third half or third portion of Robotech. So get that involved as well.
It'd be a fun double feature watching Bubblegum Crisis and then Macross 7. I feel like they have very complimentary vibes and like the same genre of music, and I love it.
Speaking of which, what did you think of the music on this? Because like, this was a show where like every episode got a soundtrack release, like a full vinyl soundtrack release at the time. And they recently released some of those as well.
Some of those songs absolutely slap.
Yeah. Konnichiwa Hurricane. Which apparently, I was looking up, got a cover in the recent Netflix Scott Pilgrim Gets a Life animated show.
Oh, yeah, actually. So if you are a fan of the 80s nostalgia, and you know, having grown up at the tail end of the 80s and then into the 90s, I wouldn't say actually that I was nostalgic for the 80s, but the music... Apparently I am. I'm just a sucker for it. The music is great.
Well, it helps that one of the big musical influences for the show was Jim Steinman. In particular, the movie City of Streets of Fire, which a bunch of the songs for that were written by Steinman. And from what I've gathered, the opening sequence of the first episode, after the little Blade Runner bit where we see each of the characters in their daily lives, but with the concert performance, they used as a reference for the edit rhythm, for edit timing, the opening scene of Streets of Fire.
Yeah, the openings to each episode had really cool editing, flashing between the credits and the action that I appreciated.
Mm-hmm.
You don't often see that kind of thing in anime. And I mean, this series as a whole really wears its influences on its sleeve. Like, it's not subtle about it.
No. Yeah, there's no question that Blade Runner is a major. They even saw characters wearing Blade Runner jackets.
Yeah, I mean, also the main band is Pris and the Replicants, so you know.
Yeah. There's some really great English reading bonuses if you pause the screen and read the English that is up on the screen. Like, there's this one map where they were like labeling things as Val Kilmer, Meg Ryan, Iceman, and Goose. I died. Frank Frazetta gets a call out in a screen in the last episode. Nice call out there.
Yeah, we did a lot of pausing watching through this, just reading everything.
I think Bernie Wrightson gets a reference as well.
So many 80s cop movies too, or at least vibes. Like,
oh yeah, there was...
I'm happy to see that they actually... Like, I don't know if this is because of the references that they were pulling from or if they made a conscious choice to do this, but it feels a little bit more multicultural than most animes. And I'm not saying the representation is great, but at least there are people of color in this show and people of obviously different, you know, ethnicities, whereas usually in anime, it's all the same features.
to get into this a little bit more, get into the premise. In the year... 2032 and 2033 goes over a couple of years. This is after the city of Tokyo has been destroyed and eventually rebuilt after a massive cataclysmic earthquake. As to be clear, real world history happens distressingly a lot. And as part of this, the Genom Corporation has developed boomers, basically cybernetic organisms, some of which are can just do like regular labor, but also they do combat boomers. And those combat boomers sometimes end up getting released in the streets of Mega Tokyo. And the AD police are unable to meaningfully stop them. So when you're in trouble and a boomer's rampaging, and if you have the money to afford it, or does they have to be available, you enter the Night Sabers, a group of basically powered armor, kind of actually tokusatsu inspired, like Super Sentai or Metal Heroes inspired characters, power armor, who will fight the boomers. And their members are rock singer Pris Asagiri, entrepreneur and also lingerie designer Sylvia Stingray. Sylvia Stingray, aerobics instructor Lina Yamazaki, and hacker and AD police computer tech, Nene Romanova. And they are occasionally allied, joined by the 80 police detective Leon McNichol and his partner Daley Wong, who, at least for the first chunk of the series, Leon is not aware that Pris, who he has a crush on, is in fact a member of the Night Savers.
Leon, the most 80s cop of 80s cops.
He's not, though.
He's not. Well, I kept expecting his wooby partner to be killed, and it didn't happen. So I was like, yeah, that was cool.
Honestly, we needed more episodes. He could have gotten killed.
So
there is a lot of fridging that happens.
Oh god, yeah.
Yeah. But of the characters that fridge, the Leon's gay partner is not one of them.
And he is gay. I wasn't sure.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
He's camp gay in Bubblegum Crisis. In 2040, he's played more straight gay. But he's always gay.
But yeah, the series is kind of, I divide it up into like three chunks. There's the first three episodes, which kind of introduces the setting. We have where the main antagonists are the head of Genom. Well, the head of Genom's always the main antagonist, and the head of the company, Quincy, who's also kind of like modeled off the old man from RoboCop.
Kind of.
A little bit.
Personality-wise, sure, but
visually, no. We've got the blonde widow's peak and the long hair and the always wearing a shirt that's kind of half open.
Honestly, every time I saw him, I couldn't. The only thing I could see was Geese Howard from Fatal Fury / King of Fighters. Yep.
And his lieutenant, Quincy's lieutenant, Brian J. Mason, who, and we learned that he, it, Mason and Celia have a connection over stuff, shady doings that Mason did in his past. And second arc, we have a new antagonist in the form of Largo, who is in fact not a new antagonist because he's actually Brian J. Mason after he gets killed at the end of the first arc.
Don't bother to explain how that happened.
Yep. He's just kind of put in a super boomer body kind of thing. And then the last couple episodes are generally, I would describe as sort of a standalone episode due to the production that led to the thing stopped.
Yeah, and for Largo's return, I'm pretty sure he just had the same life insurance policy as Palpatine.
Yep.
Well, like, I know, based on, there is a sequel series which is supposedly adapting the last five episodes into like 1 3-hour blitz that, you know, goes, that he doesn't actually, that Largo doesn't actually die, but, you know, it's just Disney villain death, but he comes back. But the canonicity of Bubblegum Crash is debatable.
Admittedly, it is clear they are kind of setting him up to come back again, because they do say the magic words, no one could survive that, which...
Yeah, I'm sitting there like, why is there always a bottomless pit?
That thing you... Yeah. Like the edge of a building? What are kind of like a weird slang?
Well, we do know that there's a massive earthquake in the backstory. It's not super hard to think that maybe there's a crevasse between these buildings that they just haven't been able to fill.
Valid. We have like more than a few like giant cliffs into massive areas of construction and debris and that sort of thing that haven't been reclaimed yet. So including the climax of like episode 5, which is the first, shows up there as well, or shows up there with the big showdown there. So yeah, like there's plenty of like big crevasses, geological upheaval to allow for this sort of.
Plus a big old artificial island explicitly said to be covered with booby traps.
Honestly, it's like, okay, why did you build? It's not even an island. It's specifically like island 35. We have real artificial islands and we have this one that is just a trap in case we need to meet with someone.
That's some cool futuristic corporation right there.
Genome Corporation, what do you make? We make boomers. Why?
The number of times David and I looked at each other and said, okay, boomer.
But they do make other things. Like, Genom's name is on the side of Pris's motorcycle. So they do establish that they do make other things.
Oh, yeah, yeah. They're one of those huge Omnicorps.
Omnicorp.
Very RoboCop-y.
Yeah.
It's always good to diversify. Like I like reading to old time or listening to old time radio shows, and it's kind of hilarious to hear ads from the early 30s where they're telling you that, hey, did you know that Tide soap flakes are so gentle. They're not just for dishes. You can use them for clothes too.
I wouldn't recommend it today.
I have got one huge question with the boomers. Like, I get why they would want, like, the sex bots, which are apparently illegal, to look human. I get why they want, like, the bodyguard bots to look human. Why do they have the primarily military bots looking human? And where does the extra mass come from when they rip off their human disguises and gain 2 feet in height?
Well, you could just say there's compact hydraulic systems before they burst out.
But they're and as solid for the look, when they expand. Unless they're like hollow at the center, you know, with, you know, a delicious chocolatey center. It doesn't make any sense. And I understand I'm saying this about an anime, but...
Yeah, you're saying this about an anime that came out after Transformers, where size is not consistent between the two forms.
No, mass shifting is definitely a thing, and it's absolutely nonsense in when Transformers do it too.
All right, back it up, back it up.
Yep.
Before we get him going on Transformers. I do want to say, though, that the sequences where we get a reveal from a human form to a boomer are so gorgeously animated. Like, the way that, this is going to sound kind of gross, the way that the skin, like, explodes off and the mechanical parts come through. And they all have human teeth, which is so horrible. Like, there was a lot of loving effort put into rendering these combat machines of doom.
Yeah, worth noting is that the animation, for the most part, is absolutely gorgeous.
You can tell the scenes that they put the love into and the scenes they just had to quickly shuffle out. which is fine. Just a production reality.
Yeah.
Yeah, when your resources are limited, you have to make choices.
Yeah. As far as for why the military boomers need to be human, I think actually in a way we get an answer to that question in the first episode with the premise involving hunting for the little girl who turns out to be a boomer with control systems to her kill sets. The answer being war crimes. They look human because they for the sake of war crimes.
Just remember, it's not a war crime the first time.
But no, I do think that is the explanation, is that there's all sorts of laws with what you can and cannot do with boomers, but it seems like most of their customers are going, it's only illegal if you get caught.
That's the problem for so many of the bad guys. It's like, well, you're going to get a fine for this. And fines are just legal if you pay, if you're rich.
Yeah.
Like, it's not illegal. It's just, you know, it's a fee you have to pay.
Yeah. Like, what's the Final Fantasy Tactics? At least that's the meme format I've seen for the quote. I don't know if it's a genuine quote because I didn't play that far into the game, but it's the... If the punishment for a crime is a fine, then that law only exists for poor people.
Yeah, no, that I depends on which translation of Final Fantasy Tactics you go with.
Yeah,
but yes,
it's capitalism.
Yeah,
like, which is a theme in Bubblegum Crisis.
Indeed, like the first arc, like the second episode, like the second or third episode of the first arc is basically is the Night Sabers trying to fight gentrification. With Genom demolishing parts of the city and displacing poor people, including Chris, and trying to and ultimately avenging a friend of Lina's who she is killed trying to retrieve stuff from their house so that they can before it is demolished, or apartment before it is the building is demolished.
Well, that's Chris's friend.
Yeah, no, it is Lina's friend, because Lina's the one who talks Vision down later, because Vision is her.
That's a different person, though. That's a different one who died.
Yeah. Oh, you're right. I'm sorry. That is that is friend of Chris in episode 3, and then Lina has the friend in episode 2, whose fiance also got murdered by Genom.
Genom just keeps killing women.
This brings up something I want to talk about, though, is that the whole time I was watching this, I was like, okay, so clearly there's a manga or a light novel or something where we get the full story, because these have obviously been compacted, right? No, there isn't. it feels like a lot of these emotional story beats where characters close to the Night Sabers get killed are really compressed. And I understand why they had to do that. But it also feels like, okay, you want me to care about this character who was killed a scene ago, who had literally one scene with Pris. Like, you know what I mean? Like, and it happens multiple times. Like, if it just happened once, it wouldn't be so bad. But it is the driving force behind, like, at least 3 episodes.
It is like a certain degree, like going from like the like not those are the noir. Actually, noir is probably the right term for it, like a comparison to make your or like the hard-boiled detective story, where you have the supporting character, often female, who is killed off not only to motivate the main character, but also to as a inciting event for the story, like an actual inciting event where this is. The rest of the story spins off from this point into the investigation to why this character died. Sometimes with this female character having a direct emotional connection, the lead. Like actually, like it does get into a couple other like hardboiled detective things as well. Like I believe Lina and like Pris both end up on the receiving end of the back off this case. If you know what's good for you, physical assault. At a couple different points, I like thinking of episode one in particular. Like Pris gets smacked around, and the phone booth where she gets attacked at comes up again later in the series.
I pointed at the screen and I said, "Ha, phone booth." Yeah. Remember those?
Yeah, that's one of those things when you're trying to predict the future. I don't know. You look at Star Trek where like they talk about how many kiloquads of data they have on those, and we have blown our data density so far past that. But yet there's other technologies that we're still not even remotely close to.
I will say at least they at least started using made up metrics.
Yeah.
But I will say that is one thing in I think it was the 8th episode where Pris destroys the camera that was taking pictures of them. And my immediate first thought is, well, at least it's all saved to the cloud.
Oh, wait.
But no.
When I was watching the show, obviously I was enjoying it. I had a great time watching it. Anyone who loves sci-fi, I think, would be into it. And I also love film noir and detective films. So I was having a great time, but I kept feeling like I was missing information.
Mm-hmm.
Like a lot of it I was able to fill in and it was okay. But like the very last episode we were watching and the Night Sabers are showing like how they train. And I was like, okay, so they do train, because it was unclear. Like
that is like the big thing is like, okay, I can see why. Cilia is doing this because we got her backstory. Her dad was killed by Gina. I can see why, you know, she's doing this revenge thing. But the reasoning for Pris and Lina is a little more unclear. And the question is, how did they even hire Nene?
So needed a hacker.
So this is where like one of the weird bonus material things come from. These are on the discs for with the physical media release from Animeego, which I backed on Kickstarter, and I believe I sent a copy to Blaine, is they have one of the music videos, they have everyone's backstory, how far except for Cilia, who formed the group, how more or less how they got recruited. And Pris was a member of a biker gang that got taken out in a boomer rampage, and Nene was investing. Basically, Nene got the Tim Drake recruitment method of she was looking into the Night Sabers, hacked her way more or less into a test trick, a trap kind of thing by created by Cilia to say, hey, if you successfully got in here, congratulations. I'd like you to join the Night Sabers.
See, if she was investigating the Night Sabers in her backstory, I feel like it would have been very natural to bring that up in the last episode when she was shepherding around the chief's daughter who was investigating the Night Sabers.
And okay, and the thing is, that is fantastic, but I'm sure Blaine will agree with me. You can't prep for it.
You can out for a second there, Dave, for Dave.
Says no credit if you don't actually put it in the show.
Yeah, if you don't get credit for it if it's not in the show. Like, if I have to hunt down the additional material, then...
Which actually makes me wonder, bringing this up from a medium standpoint. Again, these were all individually released direct-to-video episodes. So there's the question being because these, like, one music video per song. And one music video per episode. So possibly they had these music videos on the tape or laserdisc. So it's like, watch the episode and then go through the credits and the music video play.
That would still be giving you the information after it's relevant.
True. It's not still not great, but it's...
Yeah. It also doesn't do anything to address Tora's point where they should have discussed it.
Yeah.
Like, even if that's how she got there, fine. But then, you know, if that's where the captain's niece is going, and that's how Nene got hired, is Nene maybe, instead of trying to block her at every turn, should she maybe be going, okay, is she worth recruiting? Because this is one of our recruitment methods that's been established.
Yeah, I think, like, probably, like, unfortunately, and they don't explain this, so we kind of have to read into it, is for the case of the chief's niece in the final episode, they're also agree, like, she's not really here in the long term, she's visiting, so it's, yeah.
So but should the Nightsabers franchise out? Because, like, boomer crime is not just happening in Mega Tokyo.
That this is true. And we'll get to that in just in a bit, because when we get started talking about the role playing game.
Very brief thesis.
As far as, like, the main four Nightsabers themselves, what do we think about them as characters in terms of how well they're written? Chris and Sylvia tend to get a lot of the limelight. But in general, how do you feel this ensemble cast?
I think, with the exception of Mackie's perviness, they're all very interesting, very well-written characters. And each of them is filling a niche in, you know, your party.
I will say it was kind of nice that in that last episode, which was mostly about Nene, she got the spotlight. Like, at the beginning of the episode, I was like, wait, have we ever seen this chick fight? Like, she shows up, but does she ever fight? And then she's, like, cowering on the sidelines during the fight. But then by the end of the episode, we see that what she really does is, like, the hacking stuff.
She's their support.
And so that was cool. That answered that question right away.
If she was a guy, she'd be the guy in the chair.
Yeah.
Except the guy in the chair is Mackie.
But they have a guy in the chair, yeah.
And apparently his chair is also a robot that can carry other suits in it, which, honestly, that was fantastic.
Shout out to the mech design. It was very cool.
Mm-hmm.
Love how Pris's motorcycle turns into an armature suit.
The motoroid.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. That was very neat.
Yeah.
But, like, so Celia, I think, is the most competent.
She's definitely the least emotional one.
Seems like she's kind of the driving force behind everything. She's writing the software for the suit and the manufactured. She's designing the training programs, and she's making the decisions on what jobs they take.
She's Batman, and they're all, and the rest of them are her Robins.
It's kind of giving that.
Yeah.
But she doesn't talk down to them or anything. Like, they're all obviously friends.
Mm-hmm. I think Lena's probably the heart of the team. Like,
I didn't get that she was an aerobics instructor, but yeah, now that I think about it, there was a couple scenes for work, I guess.
A lot of that is because, I mean, we get a little bit of Pris's personal life seems like it's peppered throughout the whole series.
Yeah.
Whereas Lynn and Nene and Sylvie, they take turns, right? Either we get a lot in one episode or we get nothing.
Mm-hmm.
So it does feel like that, yeah, even though it's officially ensemble, it's ensemble like classic Star Trek, where you've got Kirk and Spock and Leonard McCoy. And then everyone else has a moment here and there. But at least here, they made it into every episode, wasn't it?
For the most part. Even if all they're doing is just showing up for the fight.
Yeah. So later on in the series, like, we introduced the character of Vision in a sort of one-off episode. We just make a little cameo appearance after. Reika Chang, who is the sister of supporting character from the second episode, who turns out to be of ties to the Triads.
Boom.
And also is a pop vocalist.
Look at these lovely sisters, Irene and Reika.
And apparently, so from what they picked up, there's a serious thought of killing off Pris due to potentially unreconcilable issues between the vocalist and voice actress for Pris, her record label saying, we don't like this many having this many solo songs with Pris in the show. We're not that interested in having her be in the show anymore, and thus needing to write her out of the show, but still wanting to have a singer in here as a pop singer character, as to have that musical connection. So for our big kind of episode in the limelight with Vision, if they had not been able to straighten things out, they had to write out Pris and introduce Reika, what did you think of her as a character and how she's introduced?
I would classify her as the suspiciously similar substitute. Like, you can really tell that Pris was originally being written to die in episode 6. the sudden last minute arrival of a new hard suit so that she gets to survive is very, well, I said at the time, deus ex machina.
Yeah, they never explained that, did they?
Well, it came up later in that Mackie was working on upgrades for all of them. Like, we got to see Nene's upgrade in the last episode, her new suit.
It's fine. Continue.
Yeah, that conversation, it happens, but it does feel like, you know, when JMS had to explain why Mary Jane's arm got unbroken in the middle of the other event, because one artist decided to draw with a broken arm and didn't tell the other artists who were releasing on a weekly schedule, right? It did feel like, oh, that did come out of nowhere. Let's backtrack.
But I honestly like the character. I think there's a lot of potential growth there, or there would have been if she had become a main character instead of leaving the series.
They could have done a lot of cool things with pressure on her from her grandfather and her family from the crime syndicate.
And yeah, like her number one guy who's probably actually going to take over the Triad Co. would have been very interesting. And I would have liked to, you know, seen those further interactions. But at the same time, I really like Pris, so I'm not like upset that she's stayed.
Also, shout out to that crab robot.
Oh, yeah.
And its live crab truck. Loved that.
That was on the nose in just the right ways.
I loved it.
Yeah.
But they animated that thing scuttling in the most disturbing way possible.
But no, I agree. Reika could have been a worthy addition to the group, even if Pris had stayed. But yeah, in terms of, like you're saying, this especially similar substitute, there's definitely Koi and Vans Duke vibes going on with her there. For those who know that season of the Dukes of Hazzard, how you guys do. Are you familiar with the Koi and Vans years or year?
Never really watched the Dukes of Hazzard. My closest encounter is Smallville.
Okay.
I know of them.
Yeah.
It ran 8 seasons, and I think season 5 or 6, there was a contract dispute between the stars and the network. So the network did not renew the contracts for John Scheider and the other guy whose name escapes me, because again, Smallville. So they brought in, instead of Bo and Luke, they brought in their first cousins, Koi and Vance, who are like Bo and Luke when you order them off Wish. Even like the DVD set for that has Daisy only on the cover, so they don't actually point out this is the Koi and Vance here. And then that did not work well, so they released their contracts and brought back the original 2 stars with the contracts they wanted for the rest of the series. But yes, if you see the used Dukes of Hazzard DVDs and it's only Daisy on the cover, that's the Koi and Vance years. Or year. It was one season.
One season with the cousins.
Yeah.
It's giving, I am Jiro, Shiro's twin brother, here to complete his quest.
So, talk a little bit. I mentioned they broke into a couple arcs. Of the 3 arcs, I think the middle chunk with Largo is probably the strongest, it feels like. The storyline, the part with Mason, there is like a story through line that definitely considered through there with Celia and Mason and kind of a degree of revenge there. But it feels much more cohesive in the middle once we get the introduction of Sylvie and Henri. In those episodes.
Yeah, Moonlight Rambler and Red Eyes.
This is my number one gripe that I was kind of talking about earlier, that relationships appear out of nowhere and we're expected to care about them, is like the whole beginning of that episode when Sylvie and, what's her name,
Henri,
are escaping the moon. I was into it. I was invested. That was great. And then like the next thing we know, she's being introduced as a good friend of Pris's, possibly more than that. It was unclear.
I think it was very clear. They were definitely more than friends.
And I was like, wait, when did this happen? There was a time jump.
There was. It was like a 3-month time jump.
I needed that spelled out for me. I'm sad to say. Like I needed them, someone to be like, oh yeah, you know, her for a while now. You know, she's gotten really close to Pris. And like,
well, they did say that. It was like between Nene and Lina. And it was like, oh, so we finally get to meet this woman that Pris has been with has been hanging around with for like 3 months. It was one line.
I feel like the relationship was too abrupt for Pris's extreme emotional reaction that happened.
Yeah, it was one line of dialogue. And I don't even remember if the subtitles and the English dub matched on that, because I watched it with both and they are
very different.
Yeah, they're dramatically, especially lyrics in the songs are just Not even remotely close.
Okay, I'm not going to lie. We did not watch the dub. We tried it for a little bit and then switched right back. Unsurprisingly, for the vast majority of this English cast did not do more dub work. It was done by a company in New York. So,
yeah,
not one of the main dubbers.
No, and it's like I said, the dialogue here is... I understand that the dialogue often diverges with anime between dubs and subs. I don't even know if they're done by the same people, but this is the most extreme difference I've seen.
There's an entire thing that we could go into about how getting the dub dialogue to work, like, but that's not a conversation for this, I think.
No, but yeah,
it is very fascinating.
Yeah, anything that's dubbed, they do kind of sort of try for a lip sync, which... Subtitles have the freedom to not have to be lip-synced, but then there's also how much text you want on the screen. Whereas the dub, they can get through a little more if they talk a little bit faster.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And there have been attempts to try and kind of streamline the process, some better than others. If you've ever watched an anime with the word fit system advertised in the credits and the dub audio sounds kind of clunky, that's because the word fit system very clunkily puts the English and tries to match the English dialogue with the lip flaps. Using the computer system to do it rather than having the actors kind of try it and the dub writers kind of figure out the right language for that fits the word, the lip flaps. So,
and so they talk like this.
Yeah.
But occasionally it's like this.
Yeah. Very, very either rapid or halting and not in a deliberate Shatner trying to be dramatic, Shatner being dramatic.
Okay. Or a Wade's World trying to be funny kind of way.
Yeah, exactly. So, part of the reason why I picked the show for the month of August is August is also the month of Gen Con, one of the biggest convention tabletop role-playing games, which actually this year is the same week as Otakon. And Bubblegum Crisis got a tabletop role-playing game release by Artalzorian Games, the company who also created the Cyberpunk tabletop role-playing. In fact,
you see the connection.
Yeah. Like Mike Pondsmith, the author of Cyberpunk, is also one of the co-creators of the system that's used. So I want to say up front, I definitely get how you look at Bubblegum Crisis and go, yeah, this works as a concept for a tabletop role-playing game. It's already borne out. Well, you have an ensemble cast in the show. You have enough characters for basically a tabletop role-playing game. And lots of opportunity for stories with the various boomers and that sort of thing. And when the show got, when Bubblegum Crisis got a re-release from Animego, they included the tabletop role-playing game material in there. Did either of you have the chance to peruse it before this?
No. And you know, this seems fairly solid. I think one of the strengths of adapting Bubblegum Crisis into a role-playing game is because A, it has a lot of references that the show draws from that you can also draw from to flesh out the world. And B, you can kind of flesh out the world in any direction you want because, you know, there's not a lot of source material to work with. So there are lots of... They did a decent job kind of fleshing it out for the book, I think.
Yep. I do appreciate that with it being Artalzorian involved, because one of Artalzorian's sort of tabletop role-playing game... innovations, so to speak, is what's called the life path system, where basically in character generation, they're like, okay, you are going to go through a process to create your character's backstory, either through picking options or die rolls, specifically designed for a way of generating storyline ideas and melodramatic hooks and that sort of thing for the game.
Yeah.
To fuel stories on. So, for example, setting up the connection for you could use this method to set something similar to the connection between Celia and Mason, or with Pris's backstory of her biker gang getting wiped out and that sort of thing. Also, like perusing this, I do appreciate the fact that Artalzorian basically got free reign of the model sheets and mechanical design materials and that sort of thing for this. So we get like all this really great detail for like how the hard suits look and how the little bits, fiddly bits of the fingers and how they come on and that's come on and off and that sort of thing, which I think is a great touch.
Yeah, that's
cool. So other than but yeah, and yeah, we're talking about like spinning off to fighting boomer crime in other places. I mean, we already have two kind of setups already with both Vision going off to do her thing and with the chief's niece going off to do another. I mean, I can't necessarily see Celia giving the chief's niece a hard suit, but I could absolutely see Vision ending up getting with some hard suit tech.
Yeah, I mean, you know, have it be a mob hard suit.
You can have one that merges with her crab robot.
No. The crab robot would drop it like Mackie does for Nene's suit with his giant mech. Just go in there being their tech guy.
Good times.
But yeah, no. Yeah, I think we should play this game.
Any other final thoughts on Bubblegum Crisis?
We should check to see if there's a market for Bubblegum Crisis live play.
Let's talk about the name really quick. So I was pretty sure that the name had something to do with the concept of a bubblegum dystopia, but that concept actually arose kind of like later. So David, you were telling me the main fan theories behind
the name. The main theory is that the Bubblegum Crisis refers to the point at when you're blowing a bubblegum bubble, where it can either explode and cover your face or just completely deflate. And that's kind of the point where it's the society in Mega Tokyo is with their boomers of it's either going to explode in everyone's faces and it's going to wipe them out, or it's just kind of just going to drop out from beneath, which, yeah, it makes sense. It's a theory. I don't know if the creators have stated where the name comes from, but
I thought they had. I thought I remember reading that on the Wikipedia.
Yeah. And certainly, like, even if they didn't necessarily state it, yes, they do. Creator Toshimiki Suzuki in an interview with An American Magazine, it states it there. So he issued the 1993 issue of An America.
So 2 years after it stopped, after the series stopped coming out.
And he gave that explanation that David just gave?
Yep.
Yeah. Okay.
I also see it feels appropriate considering that when this show is coming out, it's 87 to 91, the bubble economy is like at that crisis point at the time. So it does make it feel like that particular use feels timely in that, in that way.
Should we give people a preview of what to expect next month? Indeed. Or should we leave them wondering?
Next month is September. So we'd like to do something educational for varying degrees for the month of September. Since everyone's going back to school. The last two Septembers, we focused on the animation industry with Azuken, Keep Your Hands Off Azuken, and with
Shirobako.
Just Shirobako. So this time we're going to actually just do something away from animation and how it's made, and learn about a topic. And the topic I have, after much contemplation, decided to have our show's topic be, make me double check. I had one thing in mind, but I decided to call an audible slightly on this, make sure it is in fact available. Still is, I am planning to do. Yes, we are going to, next month, we are going to learn about fermentation as we are going to cover the anime series Moyashimon, which is 22 episodes across two seasons, which is a nice, reasonable chunk, actually. So, have either of you any familiarity with Moyashimon? Or
nope. I have no idea about the show, but I know a bit about fermentation. I took a class to learn how to make pickles and sauerkraut and stuff like that.
Right.
Humans will ferment anything if you look at history, just so you know.
Not just humans.
All I ever do with fermentation or with pickles is to electrocute them.
I put them on sandwiches and sometimes I just eat them straight.
Yeah, I'm allergic to cucumbers, so I'm not a fan of eating them. But when you're teaching our local curriculum's high school physics, the grade 12 physics course, by the time you've done that course, you can't explain why an electrocuted pickle glows bright orange.
This is an experiment I wish I'd done. I've never electrocuted a pickle in my life, and now I feel the lack.
Yeah, well, I like to start the year by coming up with like apples and bananas and oranges and electrocute things in alphabetical order, making sure the pickle comes last. And everyone's like,
nice.
Do you have power? Is anything working? Because there's so much resistance that you don't see any current. And then when the pickle starts to glow orange, the glass is going, wait, what? And the ones that are not paying attention start paying attention again, partly because of the glass reaction and partly because it really stinks.
To be fair about why we didn't do it, we had a terrible physics teacher.
Well, in this case, we're not just going to be talking about pickles, but we'll get to learn about miso, we'll get to learn about sake, and all sorts of other stuff.
Fermentation very big in Japanese cuisine. Lots of fermented items.
Global fermentation.
Because it helps you keep them.
Yep. And not just Japanese cuisine, but other cultures as well. I will say, there is one dish or one fermented food that is covered in the show that I first actually encountered before I watched the show on an episode of Anthony Bourdain's No Reservation. No, it is not natto.
It's not. What is it?
Again, it's not Japanese. And I will leave you, and we'll elaborate further on what it was, that fermented food was, next month.
I want to list a bunch of fermented foods.
Moyashimon is
fermented foods.
Yeah, and Moyashimon is currently available for streaming on Crunchyroll. It has not gotten a physical release yet, sadly, but one can hope that it gets one in the
future. I love food shows. I'm excited.
All right. So, catch you all next time.
And thanks again for having me on. So
please do email us if you have any questions.
Of course. And email us at animeexplorations@gmail.com. That's with two E's. Once again, Blaine, where can they find you?
So everything I do is hosted at bureau42.com. The current shows I have are a weekly old-time radio show. So each Sunday morning, I'm putting out something currently going through Hitchcock adaptations. I also have a Babylon 5 30 Years Later show, which kind of is what it says, 30 years after the date from the original broadcast. We'll cover an episode of Babylon 5. When we're in a large broadcast break, like the one that season one had between late August and late October, we will cover other things, such as He-Man and She-Ra and Jason the Wheeled Warriors and Twilight Zone and other shows that JMS did, plus the comics and novels, some of which are much better than others. Wow, there's a huge quality gap in the novels.
Yeah, there is.
Yes, I'm currently reading book 7, which is fantastic.
Which one's that?
Shadow Within.
Oh, yeah.
Gene Gavalos. Book 5 is The Touch of Your Shadow, The Whisper of Your Name. My podcasting partner and I conceded that that's in the top 20 original Babylon 5 novels ever written, mostly by virtue of the fact that they only made 18. And then the other show is 99 Years, 100 Films. So on the 28th of each month, that's a monthly show, we go through all the Best Picture winners. So I think this episode of Anime Explorations will come out just after we release our coverage of Amadeus.
Ooh, I might listen to that episode. That movie has always fascinated me.
Yeah, that was interesting because Amadeus and then the next winner, Out of Africa, are two of the only three movies that put me to sleep when I was in theaters. Both of which, for those two, I think it was mostly because I was very young. The third was Saturday Night Fever, and honestly, I don't blame Saturday Night Fever at all. Where we live, sunset is about 10 p.m., and we saw Raiders of the Lost Ark and Saturday Night Fever back-to-back at a drive-in.
Okay.
So I was like 5 years old. Saturday Night Fever started close to 1 a.m. I was probably done before the first frame hit the screen. I watched Raiders and slept through Saturday Night Fever. My sister did the opposite, but no. Yeah,
I envy you the drive-in experience. I never got one.
Okay. We can change that.
What is that? Is there still drive-in theaters?
Yeah, there's still a few around.
Yeah, in some parts of the world,
but yeah.
Yep. In Oregon, we have a drive-in theater in Newburgh.
Yeah.
Well, there you go. I think it's not too late.
I went
all three drive-ins we had in Edmonton ended up getting shut down because the movie studios themselves are like, don't you have cold winters? No one would want to go. And they stopped sending the movies, which was really confusing because I was working in a theater when that happened. It was like our one manager did that and the drive-in. He's like, okay, last week you called and applauded us because they had like the second highest box office in North America for the new Antonio Banderas movie, some thriller that came out in October or November. Wasn't a great one. And then the week later, it's like, oh, wait, it's going to be cold. You're not going to go. They're like, no, we are used to the cold. We will still go. Send us the movies. And in July and August, it's not cold. Send us the movies.
Oh, yeah.
And they just stopped sending them.
But idiocy.
Yes. But anyway, those are the active podcasts. And then John and I have plans for what we're going to do after Babylon 5. And then after what we do after Babylon 5, which is why I'm also been watching Star Trek, the original series lately, because we're doing things related to that, but not covering the TV show.
I'm a huge TOS stan. Nice.
All right. And so we'll be back next month with Moyashimon. Catch you then.